Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Age of Reinvention, a novel by Karine Tuil, read by George Newbern.
Part 1. Chapter 1. Let's begin with his wound. Yes, let's begin there. The last of the stigmata inflicted during a brutal upbringing that Sam Tahar spent his whole life escaping. It was an inch-long gash on his neck. He'd gone to a plastic surgeon in Times Square who attempted to sand it off with a grinding wheel, but it was too late. He would keep the scar forever as a souvenir, would look at it every morning and remember where he came from what place, what violence. Look at it. Touch it. They looked. They touched. The first time was always a shock. The sight of, the contact with that whitish scar which betrayed the fury of its creator, signaled the taste for a power struggle, for contradiction, a form of social brutality that, brought to incandescence, presaged eroticism, a wound that he could hide beneath a scarf, a foulard, or a turtleneck sweater so that nothing could be seen of it. That day he was concealing it behind the starched collar of a $300 shirt. Purchased in one of those luxury clothing stores that Samuel Baron only ever entered now with the vague hope of stealing from the cash register. And everything about him breathed opulence, complacency, consumerism, a zero-defect design. Everything about him denied what he had been. Even his manners were affected, his voice tinged with an aristocratic accent. This man who, in law school, had been one of the most vocal supporters of the proletarian left. One of those radicals who had used their original mortification as a social weapon. Now, newly rich, an A-list lawyer, a big spender, a thunderous orator, a lex machina. Everything about him spoke of identity change, vaulting ambition, social redemption. The exact counterpoint of what Samuel had become. Was he hallucinating? Maybe. This isn't real, thinks, prays, screams Samuel. That can't be him. Samir, that brand new famous deified man, a personal and original creation, a prince surrounded by his camarilla, with his slick, specific rhetoric. On TV, he is primped and sexy, appealing to men and women, worshipped by all. An object of jealousy, perhaps, but also of respect, a virtuoso of the bar, fearless and shameless, smashing the prosecution's argument to pieces with a jackhammer of his wit. This can't be him. That artificial courtroom wolf there in New York on CNN, his first name Americanized in capital letters, Sam Tahar, and beneath it, his occupation, lawyer, while he, Samuel, was wasting away in a dingy apartment in Clichy-sous-Bois, rented for 700 euros per month, was slaving 8 hours a day as a social worker for a charity, helping troubled youths who always seemed to ask, Baron, is that Jewish? And would spend his evenings reading, posting on literary blogs, with the username Witold92, writing pseudonymous books that were systematically rejected. His great social novel? We're still waiting for it. This can't be him. Sam Tahar, transformed beyond recognition, his face covered with a layer of beige foundation, eyes turned to the camera with the perfect command of an elite actor, lion tamer, marksman. His dark eyebrows waxed and shaped, his body corseted in a bespoke designer suit that was possibly even bought for the occasion, chosen specifically in order to seduce, persuade, attract attention, a holy trinity of political communication. The lessons that had been rammed down their throats at law school, and which Samir was now putting into practice with the arrogant self-assurance of a campaigning politician. Samir, a guest on American television, representing the families of two U.S. soldiers killed in Afghanistan, intoning a paean to interventionism, glorifying moral fiber, trying his hand at sentimentalism. Footnote. Santiago Pereira, 22, and Dennis Walter, 25. The former dreamed of becoming an artist, but was pressured into enlisting by his high-ranking father. The latter stated, "Success to me means fighting for my country." Samir, being questioned by the journalist, who treats him with deference as if he's the conscience of the free world, and remaining calm and confident, apparently having muzzled the beast within him, controlled the violence that for so long contaminated his every gesture. Footnote: Kathleen Weiner, born in 1939 in New Jersey to a shoemaking father and a housewife mother, Kathleen graduated from Harvard. But her greatest claim to fame remained her supposed liaison at the age of 16 with Norman Mailer. And yet, when you first met him, that was all you saw. The surreptitious wound, the tragic echoes of the horror of his formative years, spent inside the grimy walls of a 20-floor tower block, 15 or 20 of them, maybe even more, crammed on a stairwell that stank of dog-slash-human piss. All those years spent pent up there on the 18th floor with a view of the balconies of the tower block opposite. Sweatsuits swaying in the wind. Fake Adidas, Nike, Puma, bought for nothing in Taiwan, Ventimiglia, Marrakesh, the local Goodwill store. Sweat-stained grayish undershirts, frayed underpants, rough toilet paper, plastic tablecloths, panties misshapen by too many washes, pounds lost or gained, hung out to dry in front of the satellite dishes that swarmed over the roofs, facades like rats in darkened basements where nobody ever went anymore out of fear of the theft, rape, violence, where nobody ever went unless threatened with a pistol, knife, box cutter, knuckle duster, billy club, bottle of sulfuric acid, pump-action shotgun, pepper spray, rifle, nunchucks. This was before the unrest in the East and the arrival in bulk of weapons of war from the ex-Yugoslavia. What a godsend. Just take a family vacation and bingo, load the good stuff in the trunk among all the kids' toys. Assault rifles, automatic weapons, Uzis, Kalashnikovs, explosives with electronic detonators. Even, whatever floats your boat, rocket launchers, if you buy them cash only. So you go off to a forest where you can practice alone, no witnesses. And then you wage war in underground parking garages, sticky with puddles of engine oil and urine where nobody ever went anymore unless accompanied by a cop. And cops never went down there anymore. You wage ideological warfare in squats where 25, 30-year-old lepers rejected, remade, the world or sexual warfare in basements stinking of damp and dope smoke where 14, 15-year-olds roasted non-consenting minors. 10 or 20 of them taking it in turns because they had to prove they were men, because the violence inside them had to force its way out somehow, they told the judge, this in their defense, because they needed some kind of outlet for it. Or gang warfare carried out on wasteland turned into a battleground night and day by dozens of people crowding around to watch roomy-eyed pit bulls fighting, each of them named after some fallen dictator, Hitler being the most popular, betting heavily on the biggest, the most rabid, the most deadly, yelling at the beast to tear its opponent to shreds, to bite its fucking eyeballs, turned on by the blood, the ripped flesh, the groans of pain and dying. While Samir stayed upstairs, studying like a freak, refusing to accept a life with no future, no money, having to choose between a job as a cleaner, warehouseman, delivery driver, caretaker, security guard, or dealer. If you aim really high, if you're ambitious, wanting to impress his mother, Nabil Tahar, a cleaning lady for the Brunet family. Footnote: her employer, François Brunet, is a French politician born September 3, 1945, in Lyon, Socialist Party member and parliamentary deputy, the author of several books, the latest of which, Toward a Just World, had been a bestseller. Source Wikipedia. Nawal, a petite black-eyed brunette and model employee, knows all about them. She cleans their laundry, their dishes, their floors, their children, scouring, scrubbing, polishing and vacuuming, declaring only half her earnings, working Saturdays and public holidays, sometimes evenings in order to wait on them, their friends. Politically committed men, feverishly scanning the papers for their name, Googling themselves, and whenever they hear that someone has written an article on them, good or bad, who cares, as long as people are talking about them, happy to fuck women under 30 in rooms rented by the year, preoccupied by their weight, the ups and downs of the stock market, their wrinkles, obsessed by the loss of their youth, their savings, their hair. P. People who sleep together, work together, swap jobs, wives, mistresses, take it in turns to big each other up, lick ass and get their cocks sucked by Albanian whores, the best in the world apparently, whom they will attempt to liberate from detention centers.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.